Thank you for the kind invitation. I almost felt it was my mother introducing me. It was so kind. And thank you for the invitation to be here. It's a great pleasure. It's my first time in San Sebastian, so I'm delighted to be here and to have a chance to tell you about new work. And it's very much new work in the sense that when I guess when you envision a keynote address, you think about like a very polished paper. Yet what I'm going to tell you about is very far from a polished paper. But I felt it was new stuff, different from what I had done before, and it seemed like a good opportunity, at least for me, to get to tell you about what I'm working on. And I'm hoping to get a lot of feedback from you. So I'm not sure what the structure of this is, but I very much welcome questions as we go along. So don't feel like, I think there might be some time at the end for questions, but feel free to ask questions before. Okay, so this what I'm going to present is based on this ongoing project with Alonso de Cortari, who's a star student at Harvard, and with Oleg Itzhoki, who's a past star student at Harvard and is now full professor at Princeton University. So it's a paper on trade inequality and costly redistribution. So let me give you kind of a step back and tell you where we're coming from. So we're building on this body of empirical work that I think, in my view, has shown quite convincingly that trade integration, despite coming with great advantages, great gains for society, seems to have been associated, particularly in recent years, with increases in inequality. It's completely undisputable that if you look at the standard measures of inequality, they've gone up over the last few years. It's a bit more disputable the extent to which international trade or trade integration has been responsible for that, but there's a consensus that part of that inequality is actually driven by trade. And yet, when we think about the gains from trade, we have our theorems about how trade is good, we have our ways to get at the quantitative magnitude of the gains from trade, the issue of trade-induced inequality is one that we tend to ignore. What do I mean by that? Well, what I mean by that is that when we think about whether trade is good or how good trade is, we basically automatically invoke this Keller-Hicks compensation principle, which is we look at the effect of trade by looking at the effect of trade on individuals, and we do so by computing a compensation variation, equivalent variation, either of the two, and then we look at those individual effects and we just integrate those up, and we have theorems that say if you integrate those compensation variations, you get a net positive effect. That is, trade increases aggregate income to the point that maybe there might be some losers, but we can always compensate them. So trade is a good thing. There's always money on the table to compensate the losers. Okay? And this is how we generally think about gains from trade. That's what our theorems are based on, and that's how our standard money measures of gains from trade are based on too. Okay? Now that all makes a lot of sense, but there are some issues with this approach. And I'm not the first one to raise these issues, but what I'm going to say is going to build on this, so I need to raise them here, which is that Keller-Hicks is all about potential compensation. There is the potential to compensate the losers. So if we can engineer a change that is going to increase the pie to the point where we compensate the losers, is a good thing. But it doesn't say that we actually compensate the losers. Okay? It's an empirical question, if you will, whether compensation redistribution is large enough to make sure that those losers we could potentially compensate are actually being compensated. And second, there's this assumption buried in the Keller-Hicks criterion, which is that there is the potential to compensate the losers, but we think about that compensation as being costless. We're generating money. Maybe we need to transfer money from some rich guys that are getting even richer to the poor guys that are getting poorer, but we think we can just do that. We just give them the money. Yet we know that in reality, that's going to tend to happen through a tax system that generates distortions. So perhaps that costless approach is not the right approach. So what we're trying to do in this project is to try to build measures of the welfare implications of trade liberalization in a model in which trade, you know, there's an income distribution that is affected by trade, but in which redistribution is limited, and it's limited because it is it's not costless. It's associated with some informational frictions that tend to lead to distortionary effects from redistributing the guys that lose from trade opening. Okay, and this, in that respect, we very much built on the work of mirror leads. So we essentially have, you know, we're developing a model in which trade is going to increase inequality, but redistribution is going to happen to the point where some people are not going to be compensated by from the move to trade, and in which the compensation that actually occurs is going to be associated with some efficiency costs. Okay, so what the approach is going to be here is to try to kind of provide an answer to the extent to which trade-induced inequality, when you take into account these factors, generates gains from trade that are very different from the gains from trade that we often build. Okay, and in that sense, what I'm going to do is I'm going to propose two alternative measures to the gains from trade, and some of you might find one of them not convincing, perhaps the other one convincing. I don't want to take a strong stance on which one I think is more reasonable, but I'm going to suggest two approaches to build corrected measures from the gains from trade that take into account the fact that to the extent that trade increases inequality, we should take into account that perhaps some people are not fully compensated, and when we compensate people, there are some efficiency costs. So I'm going to build first a welfareist correction. The welfareist correction is basically going to be one that's going to take into account the fact that some people are not fully compensated. So instead of invoking the Higgs-Calder criterion, we're going to invoke a social welfare function that's going to feature some degree of inequality aversion. Okay, and this is a totally standard approach in public finance. I don't mean that this is new by any means, but there's not a lot of use of this social welfare function approach in international trade. So I'm going to go over this. Perhaps more the newer part of the project is to have this costly redistribution correction, which is going to be much more closely related to Higgs-Calder, but it's going to take into account these efficiency losses associated with trade increasing inequality and leading to changes in the behavior of agents as they move around marginal tax rates. And I'm going to show you how you can build measures that tell you by how much should you adjust the gains from trade to take into account these features. Okay? So a couple of things before we get into the meat of the argument, I want to give you a couple of quick motivations just to kind of back up my arguments in the previous slides with a couple of figures. So this is this trade-induced inequality. Just to kind of show it in a dramatic way, if I take US data, okay, 1979 to 2007, I plot the trade share, which is one standard, fairly standard measure of trade openness. You see how trade openness, you know, especially in the late 80s, 1990s, you see a very steep increase in trade openness. Okay, China, NAFTA, all these things are happening around that time. The US economy is becoming more and more open. If you plot this against the Gini coefficient of market income, or if you could do that with disposable income, you'd find a very similar pattern. These series are moving in a remarkable way. Is this a causal relationship? Obviously not. Okay, it may be, but this is not showing this. But it's kind of interesting that even though they're both increasing, I mean, there's a pretty remarkable amount of synchronization. Okay. Yes. Yes. I don't know. Yeah, I mean, it can. I'm not sure it's going to look so pretty, but we have these are series. If you go to the the world development indicators, this here, this is a measure. I got this from US data, but I'm sure there's plenty of data sets on Gini. So I mean, you can turn this into econometrics, but I don't want to do that because there's obvious issues of endogeneity and so on. There's people that have done much more careful work correlating and trying to kind of create a causal link between trade openness and inequality. Okay, so that's a motivating graph, a motivating quote. Love this quote. When I found this quote, I thought this is amazing. So this guy says, if, as will often happen, the best methods of compensation feasible involve some loss in productive efficiency, this loss will have to be taken into account. So this guy is saying, if you're trying to evaluate something and there's some efficiency cost of redistribution, you need to take them into account. It turns out that the guy that said this is Higgs, In 1939, in the article that is associated with the Calder-Hicks criterion, right? So he goes over all the argument about equivalent variation and aggregating, and in the conclusion, he says, yeah, all that's beautiful, but you know, I'm taking a stance that there's no efficiency cost, but if there is an efficiency cost, you would want to put that into the numbers. And we, my point here is that we don't do that. Okay? And I'm going to try to show you how to develop tools to do that. Now, what we're going to do is, sort of getting into a bit more of the details, there's different moving parts to this project. And what I'm going to spend a non-trivial amount of time on is just to give you a go over a very simple example that I think is going to illustrate these two corrections, even before I get into a model with sort of a lot of math and all that stuff, although the model is actually very simple. But when we go to the model, basically we're going to have a trade model of trade-induced inequality that's going to build on work by Mellets. It's going to build on a Mellets framework, but more specifically it's going to build on this previous work of Fitzhockey, which is a version of the Mellets model with heterogeneous workers rather than heterogeneous firms. Okay, so and I'll go over that, but it's going to be a model that where there's going to be an income distribution, and that income distribution is going to be affected by trade. Now we're going to want to think about redistribution and why it's costly. So for that we're going to have a compensation that is happening through the tax system, and we're going to have a very simple tax system that, again, we first sort of came across it, became really excited about it. I'm going to show you some patterns that are quite remarkable, I think, about how well a very simple equation fits redistribution in the U.S. Turns out that there's Heathcote, Violante, and others have a very recent work that pointed this out. Okay, so they beat us to the race. I'm going to show you that there's a very specific functional form for redistribution that fits the, at least U.S. data. Maybe other countries, I don't know, but U.S. data, it fits it really, really well. And then, obviously, another part of the project is building on this welfare correction, which, you know, goes back to work by Vickers, Harsanyi. It's very related to Atkinson's work, and it's there's been a revival in the public finance literature, work by Saez and others that have been using this approach to think about optimal policy in recent years. Okay. Yes. And
on that first bullet about this trade model. Yeah. I mean, you've chosen to use the Mellets model.
Yeah.
Why didn't you use the Hectorolian model?
Yes. So that's a good. It's a good question. And the reason I did that, I mean, I could give you several answers. From an empirical point of view, my reading of the literature is that it seems that a lot of this trade-induced inequality that is happening within sectors. It's not driven so much by changes in relative pay of agents in different sectors. A lot of it is, and that's what's motivated Itzhoki and Halpin and other people to work with of models of you know, trade and unemployment and trade and wage inequality that have these Mellitian features. Okay, that's one aspect. The second second answer is I and this is more taste maybe, but I really wanted it's taste, but it's going to add to what I'm going to say. I wanted a model with an income distribution. Okay, it's going to be very hard to get an income distribution that looks anything like what we see in the data with a model with a very discrete number of factors, and within factors everybody has sort of everything is sort of perfectly substitutable. You're basically going to have a series of dots. I'm going to have a model with a kind of close to a continuous, well, I'm going to have a continuous distribution of income. So if you want your model to be disciplined to match the income distribution so that then you can do counterfactuals, a model with a bit richer, with a higher, you know, higher dimensional model is the way to go. And I'll show you that working with the Mellets framework and thinking about heterogeneous workers and having a continuum of workers with imperfectly substitutable skills is actually going to allow us to go to the income distribution data and match it well. But these are two answers. But we, you know, I think if this was a theory paper and we wanted to make some sort of qualitative points, perhaps a Hectorolian model would have been sufficient. But this is, I mean, we are going to have some results, but to a large extent, we're just developing tools that I think, if anything, will be useful for quantitative analysis, not so much for sort of theory. So that's the last point. So maps to Keith's question of another aspect that is going to be key to the framework is in the quantification, where we're going to calibrate the model to be able to match exactly the U.S. distribution of income in 2007. Okay, so we're going to show you how this was not obvious to us beforehand, that even though there's going to be some objects in the model that look abstract and impossible to get out of the data, we're going to be able to use data from the income distribution to get at those primitive parameters so that we can then use the model, shock it, and see what the model tells us about how much inequality grows with trade. And in light of that, we're going to be able to know how much should we perhaps adjust our standard measures of the gains from trade. All right, let me skip that in the interest of time, but obviously there's some related work. Let me tell you what I want to do over the next few minutes. Okay, so I want to tell you about the model at some point, but I'm not going to be too disappointed if I spend most of the time with a motivating example, because I just want to give you a sense of what we're trying to do here. And afterwards, if you're interested, you can go to the details and look how we exactly model it. By the same reason, I hope to get to the calibration and tell you about the counterfactuals. But you know, this is work in progress, so I don't want you to walk out with one number in mind thinking this is the truth and this is not going to change. It may change because we're doing things as we speak. So with that in mind, let me start with this motivating example. Okay? And hopefully that will serve to illustrate the nature of the exercise here. So think about a society. Any society could be a country that is composed of a measure one of individuals. Obviously, I can have any measure, but just think about measure one. And these individuals are indexed by some ability fee. And the ability allows them to get some earnings, some income, which I'm going to denote by R of fee. Okay, and obviously, you might imagine that R of fee is increasing in fee. Okay? Think about those earnings as real earnings. So it's nominal earnings deflated by some standard price index. Now, agents' preferences are, I'm going to represent them by an indirect utility function defined over real disposable income. And disposable income is a function of income, but it's income minus the taxes that agents pay on their income, plus some compensation, some redistribution, or whatever you want to think about that. Transfers that they get from the government. Notice, in anticipation of what's coming, that I'm making this tax rule a function of income, not of ability itself. But I'm allowing this lump sum transfer, whatever it might be, to perhaps be a function of ability directly. Okay? The fact that this tax rate is not a function of ability is actually going to be key at the heart of the friction that it's going to lead to causal redistribution. It's tied to Merlis. People pay taxes based on what they earn, not on the color of their skin or their age or things like that, at least not directly. Okay? So age is a bad example, but there's all these unobservables that the tax authority doesn't see. They can only tax based on income. The cumulative distribution of fee in the population, I'm going to denote it by H, and the implied real earnings distribution by F of R. Okay? These are just some distributions. And all I'm trying to think about is how should we feel as a society about a change, in this case a trade liberalization, that is going to change the income distribution from some initial F0 of R to some other distribution of income. This is a very simple abstract way to think about trade liberalization. Perhaps it's changing the mean, it's increasing mean income, but it's also changing some aspects of the income distribution. How should I aggregate all these changes of the income distribution into one metric that we can use to think about how good that is? Okay. So what are the welfare consequences of that move? So let me remind you what we teach our students, which is, this is the way you do it. Okay. Suppose you have this lump sum transfers. I don't know what they are in reality, but suppose you have access to those. Let's forget about this. If we have lump sum transfers, we can easily compensate people. And if the only goal here to raise taxes to compensate people, let's just assume that we use this non-distortionary lump sum transfers. Okay? And assume that the government budget is balanced. This government is not doing anything. It's just collecting and distributing. Okay, it's kind of boring, but let's go with that for the time being. So what is this Keller-Hicks criterion? It says basically the following. Suppose that you compute the compensating variation. You could do that with the equivalent variation, but suppose you compute the compensating variation for an individual of type fee associated with trade opening. So you have his indirect utility before trade, that's V of his initial income, and that's V of his after trade income plus some compensation C of V. And the compensation variation is exactly defined such that this equality holds. How much money do I need to give to somebody after trade to make sure he attains the same utility he had before trade? So that's at the individual level, but then I can aggregate across agents. Okay? And if I aggregate across agents, I'm basically going to realize that if I look at all this compensation variation, some guys need to be given some amount of money to compensate them because they're losing, but obviously there's some guys that are winning, so that CV is going to be negative. So when you aggregate, you notice that this thing just basically is identical to the change in aggregate income. As long as this integral, which is no more than aggregate income after trade is higher than aggregate income before trade, that means that we can always compensate the losers. Okay? Sure, some people might lose, we need to give them money, but if we're generating more income than before, obviously we can compensate them. Okay? So that's telling you that as long as trade increases aggregate income, this is going to be a good thing, and one metric of the gains from trade, the standard one, is simply going to be the proportional percentage increase in real income. This is a standard way to measure gains from trade. Okay? And then we have theorems that I'm not going to go over now that say that under certain conditions we can always ensure that mu is positive. Okay? And then we have sort of quantitative work in recent years that is trying to get a sense of how large mu is. Okay? And it's all built on this notion that we're going to think about welfare as aggregate income, and we care about aggregate income because as long as aggregate income goes up, we can compensate people. Can maintain everybody where they were and have some people be better off. So that makes a lot of sense. I mean, there's some beautiful aspects of Keller-Hicks, and that's why it became so prevalent for so many years. First of all, I don't really care what V is. I don't know if V is whatever function it is. I don't care if it's log, if it's quadratic. I don't care if Asir has a V and I have a different V. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You're going to end up with the same exact expression. Okay, so indirect utility can be heterogeneous across agents, so the results are purely based on our ordinal preferences. It doesn't matter the curvature of this V function. Okay? So you don't have to have headaches about comparing utility across people. Okay? And that's why people believe that because of these features, then you have a measure that is free of value judgments. It's great. It's science. This is the way that economics becomes a science, is by detaching itself from ethics or any sort of ideology. Okay? It's all value judgment free. Now that's beautiful, but to me and to many people that's not so obvious. Okay? It's not so obvious because if redistribution does not take place, then it's hard to argue that you're not taking some sort of ethical stance. Okay? You're saying, okay, I'm fine with that criterion. I know some people are worse off, but I'm fine with that criterion. It's not so obvious that that's sort of a logical stance. And in particular, one way to think about it that I like is this is not just your evaluation, evaluating a change. You have a society at some point and you're doing something to society and it's changing it. From the point of view of people, you're essentially changing their position. You're giving them, you're making play some sort of lottery, right? So I was here, now I'm going to open up the trade, I might end up here, there, whatever. This is not your standard choice situation. This is, if anything, it sort of has this notion of expected utility setup. And we know from the work of von Neumann Morgenstern that ordinal preferences are not going to get you very far. Okay? We have these results that say you cannot, if you want to think about choice under uncertainty and things like that, you need to take a stance on, you need to kind of resort to some notion of cardinality. Okay? And what I'm going to do is actually going to be related to that. Okay? So this beautiful aspect of the ordinal preferences I don't think it's necessarily going to get you very far in that case, and you might want to think about risk aversion, inequality aversion as playing a role in this welfare computations. And I'll be more explicit about it. I'm not being very clear about it, but when we look at the math, I think it's going to become clear. At the same time, there's the issue that even if redistribution actually takes place, so everybody's better off, to make everybody better off, we might be burning a lot of money if we don't have access to these lump sum transfers. You do it with lump sum transfers, and they aggregate up to zero, and you don't affect income, that's beautiful, but that's not how the world works. Okay? If in order to redistribute you're burning money, you might want to take that into account. And just to give you an example, a paper that I always teach, because I love it, it's a beautiful paper, Dixon and Norman, 86. Right? So these guys come in and say, yes, we have these gains from trade results going back to Samuelson. They're great, but they're built on this Keller-Hicks and this lump sum transfers. And nobody believes in those. But we're going to show you, and this guy showed us, that you can write a totally standard neoclassical model, and all you need to do is tax commodities and tax factors. And you can show that with this much less informationally intensive instruments, you can engineer Pareto gains from trade. Okay? You guys remember that paper? Great paper, JIE 1986. Now, that's great, but the policies that they use to get that are incredibly distortionary. That is, yes, you get mu is positive, but the mu that comes out of those policies might be very, very close to zero. That is, you can engineer Pareto gains from trade, but that might lead you to gains from trade that are dramatically lower than they would be without those policies. Okay, and that's not the point of their paper, but it's sort of, I think it's an example, you know, when we think about this, we have to think about that these guys are engineering Pareto gains from trade by dramatically reducing the gains from trade. De facto, they're almost bringing the economy back to autarky. Okay? So now let me go back to this, but let me give you a bit more of more details about exactly what we're doing here. So I'm going to develop a couple of alternative metrics of the gains from trade that are going to be variants of this mu measure. Is everybody on board? So the first one that I want to talk about is this welfare risk correction, which again in the field of public finance is fairly standard, is used fairly often. Okay? So one way to think about it, this is going back to Vickery, is to consider an original position in which individuals are evaluating this policy, whether we open up to trade or not, but suppose that they were to do so under the veil of ignorance, that is, without knowing exactly what fee is, their own fee is. In that case, it would make sense that if you think about this as a decision of choice under uncertainty, that is, I don't know exactly what my income is going to be tomorrow, okay, you would evaluate that based on some preferences defined over the income, disposable income that I would have under certain state of the world, weighted by the probabilities of these weights of the world, okay? Which is no more than what my indirect utility would be, or my indirect utility from that real income would be for different values of fee. Okay? This is how I would evaluate my welfare given a distribution of ability. And in analogously to the von Neumann-Morgenstern preferences, one might want to posit that G should actually be concave. And concavity here would reflect risk aversion, the fact that I am risk averse, so I'm holding constant the mean, any distribution of income that is associated with higher inequality is going to reduce my welfare. That's one way to think about it. An alternative way to think about it is, forget about this veil of ignorance and all this junk. I am just a social planner that cares about redistribution, that cares about inequality. For me, it's not the same to give $1 to somebody that already has a million and taking it away from somebody that has 10 than to do it the other way around. I don't see those things as being the same, because I think that the marginal utility of income of very rich people should be much lower than of very low people, of very poor people. Okay, so this could be a social planner induced concavity, in which case, instead of thinking about this as risk aversion, you might want to call that inequality aversion. Okay? I don't care exactly how you want to think about that, but either of those would tell you that there should be some concavity to that function. let me parameterize that in a way that is fairly common as well, at least going back to the work of Atkinson, which is to think about this g function as being a power function governed by a single parameter rho that governs how concave that function is. Okay, so if rho goes to 0, this is linear in rho, sorry, in R. So you basically have risk neutrality, inequality, neutrality. But as rho becomes larger and larger, this g function becomes more and more concave. Okay? What's nice about this is that if you take a very simple transformation of this welfarist measure, you basically see that without inequality aversion or without risk aversion, your standard, this welfare measure is equal to mean income. Okay, so without any inequality aversion, if I look at changes in welfare, they're going to be associated with changes in mean income. But with a rho higher than 0, that's no longer going to be the case, because welfare is going to be this power function of the expectation of the power function of income, and you can just, using Jensen's inequality, you're going to see that if there's any amount of inequality, welfare is going to tend to be lower. Okay? So other things equal, if the distribution of income is unequal, if not all of us have the same mean income, I'm going to associate that with lower welfare than in a world in which everybody had exactly the same amount of income. Now, more interestingly, and this is we're going to get the first sort of useful analytical result, if you have certain distributions of income that are closed under power transformations, it's going to turn out to be the case that we can express this corrected measure of social welfare as a simple modified mean income where the modification is going to be tied to some features of the income distribution, in particular the Gini coefficient. What do I mean by that? Take two examples. Suppose that the distribution of income, the distribution of disposable income is Pareto distributed. The Pareto distribution is one that is closed under power transformations. It's going to turn out to be the case that this welfarist measure of welfare is given by this expression here. So you have, it's multiplicatively separable in R, which is aggregate income, but now you have this term in front of it, which is a function of rho, and is a function of G, where G is the Gini coefficient associated with that income distribution. And if you sit down and take the derivative, you'll see that this function is decreasing in G. The higher is the Gini coefficient, the lower should welfare be, holding constant aggregate income. Okay, so this inequality-averse social planner, or the society that features risk-averse agents, other things equal, is going to put a lower welfare value to a distribution that is associated with the same amount of income, but a higher Gini coefficient. But this formula tells you a very simple way. If you give me the Gini and you give me R, I can give you welfare in a second. The log normal is another case, even simpler, okay? Because the log normal distribution is one that is also closed under power transformation. Okay? And again, you see that higher Gini coefficients are going to tend to depress welfare. Not only that, but the fact that this thing is multiplicatively separable implies that if I look at changes in aggregate welfare, which remember under Calder-Hicks were equal to mu, this is simply going to be a simple function of this growth in mu, but this term that is associated with trade-induced inequality. If trade is not only increasing aggregate income as reflected by mu, but it's also increasing the Gini, then this term is going to be lower than that, so that's going to tend to kind of push down the welfare gains from trade. Because, yes, income is going up, but the Gini is going up, so we shouldn't feel so good about this. And this gives you a specific, exact way in which that adjustment should happen. Now, if we knew that the income distribution is exactly Pareto or log normal, and we knew exactly by how much trade increases the Gini, I could just use Excel to give you exactly that thing. Now, matters are going to be a little bit more complicated because A, the income distribution is neither Pareto nor log normal, and B, because as I'll argue in a second, I'm going to actually need a model to know exactly by how much does trade increase G. I observe changes in trade and changes in Gini in the data, but I don't know exactly how much of that increase in the Gini I observe in the data is actually coming from trade. So I'm going to have to use a model to compute that counterfactual.
What's the grossness of the function just G around the
cycle? No, because that's a typo. Yes. This is, yes. I keep meaning to correct that. Okay, so let me give you a preliminary. I want to go to the model at some point and use the model to answer that question. But it's if you have a beautiful formula like this, it's hard not to use it. Okay, so I'm going to use it even though I may not be using it wisely. So let's ask this question. How large is the negative correction to social welfare associated with trade-induced inequality, taking the US during the period 1979 to 2007, where I showed you the pictures before, those two series, the trade share increased from 9.2 to 14%, when the Gini coefficient of disposable income, okay, after redistribution, increased from 0.37 to 0.49. Okay, so even though there's a progressive tax system in the US, and you know, poor people are compensated somehow, still over this period we observed a very dramatic increase in the Gini coefficient of disposable income. Okay, and that's what matters. See, the G here is the G of disposable income. Okay? So in order to give an answer to what it is, we need to know how much did the rise in the trade share increase aggregate disposable income. That's mu. Okay, obviously the mu increased a lot in the US, by how much is it related to trade? And how much of the increase in the Gini is caused by trade? These are two things that we are going to have a model to kind of give us a sense of that. But we can, in the meantime, we can just get some numbers from the literature. I would argue that my reading of the empirical literature on sort of estimating the gains from trade would say that 3% is not a bad measure of the static gains from trade. Okay, so if you kind of use the Arkolakis et al. Formula or things of that nature, this 3% growth in income coming from that change in the trade share would be ballpark right. To a lot of people, including myself, this looks like a ridiculously low number. Okay, and that's why we think that perhaps our models are not fully capturing the gains from trade integration. But I'm not sure how these dynamic aspects of the gains from trade interact with what I'm talking about. Okay, so I'm going to have a model where all the gains from trade are going to be static, and I'm going to look at trade-induced inequality from trade opening in the standard way. Okay? So that's what I'm going to do. I'm just going to put a 3% here, and I'm going to say that trade-induced 5, 10, maybe 20% of the increase in the Gini. You might say that 5% of the increase in the Gini is ridiculously low. You might say that 20% is ridiculously high. I'm giving you a range. Maybe you think 5 is ridiculously high. Maybe I'm overstating them, even in the lowest numbers. But I just want to give you a range of numbers at that point. So then you go and you compute this thing. It's not so hard. You just plug these numbers in the formula, right? I mean, I just need to know. I know what G0 was in 79. I have this counterfactual G1, depending on how much of trade there. And then I have mu, which is 3%. So I put these numbers, and obviously, without inequality aversion, the welfare measures are all 3%, because even though the Gini is increasing, I don't put any weight on that. But as I become more and more inequality averse, you see that the implied gains from trade go down and down. Okay, this is the Pareto case. This is the log normal case. And notice that if you go, for instance, to rho equal to 1, which is log utility, which macro people love. I don't know why, but they love it. They think it's the best. If you go to log utility, you see that it doesn't take a lot of, well, I don't know a lot, but it, I mean, not 20% growth of the Gini being related to trade is sufficient to kind of close to erode the gains from trade. Okay, so this is, you know, we might argue, and my own view is that rho equal to 1 is probably too much inequality aversion. I think 20% is a high number, so I'm not saying that trade is bad. I don't think that this is a realistic region in the parameter space, but all it's showing you is that this formula is showing you that these effects could be powerful enough to actually significantly erode the gains from trade. Okay? This is just to kind of show you that this is not just moving from 3% to 2.9% no matter what. That there's actually situations where this is a non-trivial adjustment. So that's the welfareist adjustment. Now let me tell you, you know, obviously then later, I'm not sure how much time I'll have, when you go to the model is going to tell you exactly what mu is, what is the mu that best matches the data. And then we're also going to know exactly what the right S is, given what the model and the data are telling us. And that, with those numbers, I'm going to come back to, and I'm going to show you, just to anticipate things, because I'm probably going to run out of time, that at this point, we're sort of converging toward thinking about that about one-fifth of the gains from trade are gone. Okay, so you need to kind of multiply by 0.8 the standard gains from trade. This is what we get with standard measures of rho when we go to the model. Okay, so this is way too extreme, but we still get sizable adjustments when we pick numbers that are appear to be reasonable. Now let me tell you, if this is clear, let me tell you about the second adjustment that we built, which is, I guess it's more novel, not just in trade, but also in other fields. And with that, what we do is forget about this notion that we can compensate the losers in an undistorted manner, okay? Because we don't tend to see that. And just assume that the bulk of redistribution happens through the income tax system. In the US, I think this is close to right. There's a trade assistance program, but it's ridiculously small. We don't think that it has a lot of power in sort of compensating the losers. And that might be as close as you might get to TFE in the US redistribution system. That's small, so let's just assume that it's all happening through the tax system. And let's focus on this particular case, which I mentioned before, in which this 1 minus tau, which is the net of tax return on your income, is a power function of your market income. Okay, so you get some market income, and then out of that market income, you're going to subtract some amount of money the government's going to take. Suppose that the tax system is such that the more income you get, the more the government takes from you. Okay, so it's a progressive tax system where fee, this parameter fee, is government governing the degree of tax progressivity. Okay? And in particular, if fee were zero, then this wouldn't feature no progressivity. Okay? But as you increase fee, the tax system becomes more and more progressive. What's nice about this is that basically disposable income, if you multiply this by R, you have disposable income. Disposable income is a power function of your market income. It basically, it's a concave transformation of your market income. Okay, so, but what's going to turn out to be nice is that if you take logs, it's a linear function. I'll show you in a second. Your disposable income is the log of your disposable income is a linear function of your market income, and that's going to turn out to match the data remarkably. The other feature that we're going to build into the model is not just a tax system that sort of spits out disposable income when you put in market income, but we also want to generate some distortions from that tax system. So we need to introduce some sort of behavioral responses to the tax system. And the way that we think about this is by introducing an elasticity of market income to the tax system. Okay? So if you start taxing people more, their market income is going to go down. Now, I want to think, in the model we're going to think about this as a labor supply decision. If you start increasing my marginal tax rate, I'm going to start working a bit less than I would otherwise. Or I'm going to start hiring less people than I would because I need to pay all these taxes. Okay? So that's one way to generate an elasticity of market income to the tax rate. It's outside the model. You can think about this as sort of tax elusion or tax evasion too, which is the more you kind of start putting taxes, maybe the income is generated, but it's really not flowing through the tax system because people start doing things on the side. Okay, but what's buried here is this notion that I have a single parameter epsilon that is capturing by how much is income changing when I tax people. So now you see that if I do something that I tend to tax more the rich, and I have that with trade, maybe rich people become even richer. As they become richer, they're going to move to higher marginal tax rates. So if I want to compensate the losers, I might have to tax those very rich people, but they're going to start working less or not hiring as many people. So that's going to generate losses in income generation, the generation of income coming from the fact that there's a tax system that is leading to distortions. So now the issue is, what's convenient about all this is that notice that the tax system is log linear, and this is a constant elasticity as well. And you'll see that that's actually going to lead to measures of welfare that are, again, going to be very simple functions of mean income and the Gini coefficient. But before I show you that formula, let me tell you what I mentioned before, which is as ad hoc as this formula may sound, it fits the data remarkably well. Okay, and I'm using CBO data here for several percentiles of the income distribution. This is pulling all years together. I'm going to show you later data for 2007. And it holds year by year. The slope might change, but it holds year by year. If you plot lock market income against lock disposable income, where disposable income is income minus taxes plus transfers, you see that obviously poor people can have a disposable income that is higher than their market income because they get transfers from the government. Rich people get less than their market income because they pay taxes, but they don't get a lot in terms of transfers. But this is close to a linear function. There's bunching because of years and things like that, but the fit is, you know, if you run this with year fixed effects and things like that, the fit is equally good. Okay? So that's why this may look ad hoc, but it's actually pretty close to at least U.S. data fitting the data very well. Yes.
Is there any data?
Yeah, no, that's a good point. I think the short answer is you're taking me away from my comfort zone. So I'm pretty sure that the public finance literature has established that there are differences in these epsilons, and that and the epsilons might change also when you change policies and things like that. But at the same time, we see this being used in the public finance field a lot. A constant epsilon. So if that is a well-functioning field, I would imagine that the differences are not large enough for people to find this type of modeling as crazy. Okay. Having said that, the model we have is actually one that, even though the epsilon in our model is not exactly going to be constant. So when we do the quantification, we are allowing for through extensive margin responses, it's going to turn out that epsilon is not constant. But I'm not sure I'm going to get to that. Yes. Yes. Well, that's where I want to push back, but I want to be careful, which is, you know, if the rich people are finding ways to not pay taxes, why should that not be a factor for income, for welfare? I mean, that's less money that is going to the government. It's going to constrain the amount of services the government can provide. I'm not sure that the fact that some of it is tax evasion means that it's not relevant for what I'm talking about. Okay, so and at the same time, even though obviously there's tax evasion, you have to think about behavioral responses that are not just about how much I declare, but also what do I do with my firm? Do I expand it? Do I not expand it? Do I do this? Do I open a new plan or not? And those are decisions that that might be affected by the tax system, the corporate tax rate, and things like that. Okay? But I don't know exactly how to think about tax evasion. I don't know how it fits with what I'm saying. I would presume that in the US there might be less than in other countries, but I don't know. So that's pulling all years together. You can obviously, as I said, you can estimate fees just related to the slope of this thing. So you can do it year by year. So that's what you do here. It's around 0.2, depending on the years. You can almost see the Republicans and Democrats cycles here. You know, this increasing progressivity is Obama, this is Bush, you know how it works. Okay. So that's for another paper. But just to tell you that it's pretty tightly estimated, and something around 0.2, 0.18 is ballpark, right, depending on the year you're picking. So here's a bunch of ugly math, but let me give you the gist of it, which is the fact that you have a tax system that is log linear, that disposable income is going to be a log linear function of market income, and the fact that you have this constant elasticity basically means that when you compute aggregate income, Okay, the aggregate income that is generated by this economy is going to turn out to be a function, a power function, of the expectation of the power of this object, which I'm calling R tilde, which is, you can think about it as potential income, which would be the income that the economy would generate in the absence of distortionary taxation. Suppose that we lived in a Calder-Hicks world in which we could use lump sum transfers to compensate people. How much would the economy generate in terms of income? Call that R tilde. This is a way to tell you that aggregate welfare, or aggregate income in this case, is not going to be R tilde, or the expectation of R tilde. It's going to be something different, because in order to generate that income, you need people to kind of want to do it. And if there's taxes, they might be less likely to do it. Especially people that get taxed are going to work less. People that get subsidies or transfers, they might work more than they would otherwise. But the balance of these things is given by this ugly expression here. But there's something I had never heard about, which is called a holder's inequality, that tells you that actually this is less than R tilde. So again, any society in which there's inequality is going to generate less income than a society that features no inequality. And this is not about Vickrey or welfareist, all that stuff. I'm talking about aggregate income. This is just telling you that when there's more inequality, there's going to be less income to everybody to enjoy. And it's going to be the case because the tax system is distortionary, and resources are burnt in the process of compensation. Now again, when you have this power functions floating around, you kind of, I mean, the expose was obvious. It's obvious, I guess, but to our surprise initially, at least, you can again compute these measures of welfare, in this case, this object here, and show that it's again going to be multiplicatively severable in aggregate income in the absence of taxation, this potential income, and this terms, this correction terms, that are now a function of G, the Gini coefficient, as before. And you see that I'm consistently making typos. But they're also a function now of phi, which is the tax progressivity, and epsilon, which is the behavioral elasticity. So before we had correction terms that were a function of G and rho. I didn't like G because I was inequality averse. Now I don't like G because I know that if epsilon is positive and there's tax progressivity, if I have a higher Gini coefficient, I'm going to be burning resources relative to a situation where there was no inequality. And just to see it in terms of the effects of trade, when I look at the change in welfare of this costly redistribution measure, it's going to be related to the potential gain in aggregate income, as we would compute in a model in which there's costly redistribution, but there's now this adjustment that tells you that as long as the Gini coefficient goes up with trade, perhaps our growth in income is not going to be your standard mu tilde. It's actually going to be something different. Okay. But if I know epsilon, I know phi, and I know g and the contribution of trade to g, I can again put numbers on this. So again, I can do exactly what I did before. I think this assumes epsilon is 0.5. There's a lot of debate about what epsilon is in the data, but 0.5 is something that most public finance folks think is reasonable. Sorry, I'm not doing that. Hold on. Let me back up for a second. I'm actually going to give you this correction for different values of epsilon. All I'm doing is I'm setting phi to the US level, which I think is like the average of this. I think I do 0.18. Okay? So, but you can, you know, perhaps this is sort of a relevant number, 0.5 would be a reasonable one. It's showing you that if the contribution of trade to inequality is sufficiently large, particularly in the Pareto case, you can engineer very significant reductions in welfare. And if you were to think that epsilon is very high, and there's some macro folks, Rogerson and others, that sometimes argue that epsilon is way higher than 0.5, you can get very sizable, crazy sizable correction. Okay, because in those cases, if epsilon is very high for the rich guys, if you tax them a little bit more, they might actually work much less or hire much less, and you can engineer very dramatic falls in aggregate income. Okay? So that's probably crazy regions of the parameter space. But notice that again, this corrections, particularly in the Pareto case, can be sizable. Now, I think there's a good reason why in the Pareto case, these numbers are more sizable than in the log normal case. And the reason, again, is all this is really coming from the super rich, the 1%. These are the guys that if you have a distribution of income where there's some very rich people and they start moving things around, they can move aggregate income a lot. Now, with the log normal, there's only so much you can do of that because it has a pretty thin right tail. But if you allow the Pareto tail to be sufficiently sizable, you can generate much bigger numbers. And that's sort of a cautionary tale that tells you, fine, I buy these measures, but I want to make sure that I'm calibrating the model to the right income distribution. Because I might like Pareto because I know it kind of, it seems like it fits the right tail well. This is what size and other people have told us. But at the same time, the bulk of the income distribution is log normal. So should I be using this numbers or that number? So again, these formulas give you a sense of magnitudes, but you want to make sure that at the end of the day, you go to income distributions that are close to those that we observe in the data. That's what we do in the model. How am I doing on time? 20 minutes. Okay, great. So what I want to do next is to go to the model, and I'm going to use the model for this was just, hopefully it helped to clarify what I'm doing, but it should be clear too that I still need to do something, I still need a model. And I need a model that I can discipline with the data. I need a model because I want to know what is a reasonable measure of the gains from trade in a model in which there's an income distribution. I want to know what's the relevant S, by how much is inequality going up as a result of trade and only trade. The model will also be useful for sort of disciplining, looking at the data in an informed manner so that I know what is the right distribution of income that I should be computing these things on. Okay? So let me tell you about the model and then I'll tell you a bit about the calibration. So the model is going to be a model in which, again, we are thinking about a society that is composed of a unit measure of individuals, and again their heterogeneous inability, I'm going to denote ability by phi, and again it's drawn from some distribution h of phi. Okay? So as in my simple example. Now each household is going to provide its own differentiated good or task. So what they do is different from what other people do, and there's going to be a market for what they do. Okay, think about trading tasks, or I don't know, I mean it's fairly abstract, but think about some differentiation in what we all do. Now, given somebody's labor supply L, their output is linear in that labor supply, and linear in a way that is governed by this coefficient phi. So higher ability people, they're able to get more out of their time, okay? More output out of their time. That's our sense of what ability is. So I said there's some differentiation in this task, and we're going to assume that aggregate income in the economy, society is a simple CS aggregator of those tasks, so that we have a unique parameter, beta, that governs how substitutable these tasks are. And the higher is beta, notice, the higher is the amount of substitutability. Okay, and the lower is beta, the more differentiation, the more market power, if you will, these guys are going to have. Okay, or the more differentiated their product is going to be. Now, the revenue, the income, the market income of household phi, forget about taxes for now, if you kind of work with these expressions, you can show it's going to be a simple concave function of their output, where beta is going to govern concavity. Okay, so essentially, the lower is beta, the more steeply marginal revenue is going to fall with output. Okay, so basically, that's going to make the income function more concave. And Q is some sort of aggregate final output in the economy. I should have said that, but I'm focusing on the closed economy for now. Okay, so I want to talk about closed economy when I tell you about opening to trade. Preferences. Consumers like to consume. Agents like to consume. So their utility is defined over their consumption of this final output minus labor supply. So they like to consume goods, but they also like to have a good time. They like leisure. And the more they work, the less leisure they have. So a simple way to capture that is that the more you work, the lower your utility with the constant elasticity gamma. Okay, so that's going to be tight. Epsilon is going to be closely tight. It's 1 over phi gamma minus 1. Okay, so here it's going to be constant. In a closed economy, we have a constant elasticity. When we open up the trade, it's a little bit trickier. Okay, and a buried assumption here, again, I don't like this assumption, but it's standard, and I don't know if I could live without it, is that there's no income effect. So you have this quasi-linearity here, so there's no sense in which, you know, people are going to work harder because of changes in relative prices of consumption and leisure, not because they're richer or not richer. Yet, probably in real life, there are income effects to the labor supply decision. But those are not here. And obviously, it'd be tricky to put them in, because if trade affects aggregate income, I mean, it sort of would complicate matters. Okay? Now, in terms of taxation, this is where we invoke Merlis, which is we have these people that differ in fee, and their fee translates in some income R of fee, but we cannot tax based on fee. We cannot have everybody pay some taxes depending on their ability, because the government does not observe their ability. They only observe their income. Okay, so agents' households are taxed according to a tax schedule, which is a function of R, reported income, rather than their ability. And then consumers are left with a disposable income, which is R of fee minus T of R, how much they pay to the government. And then the household is going to optimize, is going to choose labor input to maximize its utility given this production function, the revenue function here, and the budget constraint 8, which is their disposable income. Now we could sort of look at general tax rules, but hopefully I convinced you that looking at a tax system in which disposable income is a simple power function of market income, it's going to get you pretty close to what we see in the data, at least for the US. Okay, so I'm just going to use that and move, forget about this abstract T, and just have this tax rule and impose government, that the government budget is balanced. Okay? Now the equilibrium, I'm going to spare you the details because I want to talk about the open economy and calibration. But you can show that the combination of constant price elasticity of demand, constant elasticity of labor supply, and this log linear tax rule basically is going to imply that if you give me ability, fee, your consumption and also your utility and your labor supply is going to be a power function of. So if you have, and in a way that with a power that is very intuitive, there's not going to be higher after-tax income inequality, higher inequality in disposable income, the more substitutable tasks are, the more elastic labor supply is, and the less progressive taxes are. Okay, so let me pause and give you intuition. If tasks are more substitutable, okay, if what Keith and I do is perceived to be close to perfect substitutes, the fact that his ability is 10% higher than mine is going to confer to him a huge market share relative to me. Because people like our product just about the same, but he is more efficient at producing. He can sell at a lower price. So he's going to be way richer than I'm going to be if what we do is fairly substitutable. If it's not, if it's more differentiated, he's better than me, but people like to variety, whatever it may be, so they're going to buy from me, so he's not going to be so much richer than me. If labor supply is more elastic, you're going to get something similar, which is because he's a higher ability guy, the cost of leisure for him is going to be higher, so he's going to work much more than I will, so he's going to be richer than I'm going to be. And if the taxes are less progressive, then not only is he going to generate so much income, but the government is going to let him keep it relative to a situation where he would transfer. So that's why these parameters affect how much inequality there is in the model. And if you have distributions of ability that are closed under power transformations, and the Pareto, the log normal, combinations of both, mixtures of both would work, you're basically going to get that the distribution of disposable income is going to inherit that property. In this model, in the closed economy, if the distribution of ability is Pareto, the distribution of disposable income is going to be Pareto. If the distribution of ability is log normal, the distribution of disposable income, consumption, utility, everything is going to be Pareto. Log normal, sorry. So what basically means is that in the closed economy, I can actually go back to the formulas I have and use those formulas. It works exactly. I don't have to solve the whole model. I could give you exactly welfare metrics in the closed economy. Okay, and that's the slide, but I'm going to skip it in the interest of time. This is sort of saying, even though this is a more well-defined model than the example I had before, it actually maps to exactly what we had before. Now let me tell you how we think about trade. Okay, so in order to open the model to trade, we're going to do something analogous to what Mellitz did, which is we're going to consider a world economy that has n plus 1 symmetric countries, okay, this one country and n other countries, and we're going to assume that households now, they can not only sell their output to their local economy, but they might be able to sell some of their output, their tasks, to guys abroad. You can think about that as trade, maybe think about it as offshoring, I don't know. This is an abstract model, I don't need to take a stance on that. We are going to assume, however, that it's causative trade. There's two types of trade frictions. There are symmetric iceberg trade costs, so that you need to shift more of the task than they're going to receive offshore. And then that there are going to be fixed costs of exporting. So if you want to sell to another market, before you sell the first unit, you need to incur some fixed costs, which is a function of the number of markets to which you're serving. Okay, so we're going to pick here this functional form. This is something that we can easily change. And we will change. Well, we have to do a lot of robustness here. But we have this feature that we're basically making it increasingly costly for agents to service more and more markets. Okay, and this is different than Mellitz. In Mellitz, if you remember his framework, there's a fixed cost of exporting, but it's common for all markets. So either you have non-exporters, or you have exporters that sell everywhere. Okay? Now, we don't want that because we want to have a model where, anticipating what we're going to see, in which only the higher ability guys are going to find it optimal to export, but we also want to smooth how many markets richer and richer people sell to. So that when we look at the effect of trade, it has more of a smooth effect on the income distribution than something where all of a sudden, if I take the previous closed economy and I had the Mellitz assumption, I would have the guys that don't sell, it's the same, and then a bunch of guys, boom, they sort of, you have a very discrete jump in the income distribution. That's not plausible. So what this does, it basically is going to smooth out, and as you open up to trade, there's some guys that are perhaps going to sell to one market, two markets, three markets, and that's going to increase inequality as it would in the case of the Mellitz assumption, but it's going to increase inequality in a smoother way, which I think is a little bit more palatable. Okay? And alpha is a parameter that's going to govern that. Of course. No, I don't think so. Because if it's symmetric, it would, you know, I don't see why somebody would not sell to all markets. Okay, I see what you're saying. So, yes, okay, I see what you're saying. So you're saying that richer people, everybody would sell to all the same markets, but richer people would access it. Yeah, okay. All right. Yes. Okay, I take it back. It might work. It might work. I mean, I like this. I mean, I like this better because. Yeah. I could. Exactly. I can see how it would be isomorphic. At the end of the day, the one issue where I would push back is that I find it quite plausible that higher ability people are going to market their output to more markets. And not only I find it plausible, but we haven't done that yet, but I'm hoping to discipline the model even more with data. And that would be one way to discipline the model, by using that variation in the extensive margin. It's going to be much simpler to look at that than to look at the sort of extensive margin that you have in mind. That'd be hard to find data to kind of get at that. I mean, he did, you can do it for some stuff, but not like broadly. Okay, but yeah, I take it back. I think that you could do some of that. So basically what we have then is, if you follow the layout of the model, you have this households that are getting some income, and now it's a function of their output, but now they're selling this output not in their local market, but also in this foreign market at some trade cost, and this number of markets is again going to be individual specific. Okay, and quite intuitively, the higher the ability of the agent, the more markets it's going to sell output to. Okay. On the tax side, I'm not going to change anything. I'm going to have exactly the same tax rule. The only thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to assume that the government does not observe how you generated income. Again, the only thing they see is your income. They don't know whether your income came from sales to three markets, the domestic market, or not. So you cannot, the tax system is not conditioning on the exporting decision. I think we could relax that, but it would change some things, and we haven't done it yet. And one way to think about it is that whatever business expense you incurred in exporting, it's not tax deductible. Okay. So with that in mind, then the disposable income of agents is the same as before, in that you generate some market income, you pay some taxes, and now you also incur these expenses if you choose to sell abroad. And it's kind of clear from this that if your ability is pretty low, it's not going to be worthwhile for you to export, because there's a sort of fixed cost of doing so. So that's going to generate selection into exporting, as in mallets, but in a way that is smoother, because the higher his fee, the more markets that this guy will be able to kind of get income from. Okay. So then as a result, you basically have that trade is going to increase inequality of revenues and utilities, in the sense that before trade opening, notice that everybody was getting an income that was a power function of ability. And now we have the same power function, but there's this chunks that are, these terms that are higher than one, that are added to different segments, and those terms are increasingly higher, the higher is the ability. Okay, so some guys are getting same income, others more, and the higher ability people are increasing their revenues by more than those that are lower. Okay, so as a result, as long as there's some selection into exporting, you're going to tend to have effects on income that, you know, basically where the lowest ability people have their income go down, and their higher ability people have their income go up. Okay, in the same manner that in mallets you have some firms shrink, others expand. Now, I should emphasize, however, that in terms of welfare, it's going to turn out to be the case that this is a model where nobody loses. Okay, in utility terms, perhaps their revenue goes down, but their labor supply decision goes down. So this is a model where even the lowest ability people are going to gain from trade. Now you might say, how can you do this, right? You came here talking about losers, and then you have a model where nobody loses from trade. So this is something, this is part of the reason why this is work in progress. Because even though there's good reasons why this happens here, and even though you can do the same adjustments that I talked about, even when nobody loses, there's no reason why those adjustments wouldn't work, I do think that this is something where we might be off. So we might want to model that a little bit more flexible, where that would allow there to be real utility losses, not just income losses, but utility losses from trade. Okay. So let me tell you how we, with its sort of limitations, how we take the model and we map it to the data, so that we can see how, if you shock the model and look at trade opening in the model, how much inequality goes up and how large are the adjustments that I mentioned. Do I have 5 minutes? Yeah. So very simply, what we do is, what we're going to do is calibrate the model to 2007 US data. So we're going to use data on the US trade share. We're going to have fine details on the US income distribution. And we're going to use the tax progressivity rule that I showed you before already. And then we're going to take the model that we've calibrated, and we'll say, what happens if you shut down trade? You move to autarky. What would happen to aggregate income? It's going to go down. By how much? But not only that, what's happening to the income distribution? Is it getting less unequal as we would have anticipated? Of course, we saw that, but by how much? And how do you weigh those things given the calibration of the model? Okay. So that's what we're going to do. So again, this is work in progress, in the sense that some of the parameters that I'm using are not really calibrated. It's more of a simulation. We're picking some parameters that hopefully we can estimate with data in the next few months. For now, but yet I'm going to call this calibration because I think that we've done quite a bit of calibration. There's quite a lot of data that's been used for this exercise, so I'll highlight that. But for instance, beta, which is this market power of agents or substitutability, we're using Weinstein markup data. There's a variety of things that seem to indicate that beta is about 0.75, so we're going with that measure, but perhaps we could do more on that. Iceberg trade costs, Mallet's Redding, Anderson van Winkup, 1.83. Presumably we could use more trade data to kind of discipline it better. Number of countries, it's hard to envision what N is. Certainly N equal to 200 makes no sense because this is a model of symmetric countries. So there are no 200 countries like the US in the world. So 10, perhaps 5 would be better. We've gone with 10, but Alonso tells me that if you pick anything above 5, it doesn't make any difference because not a lot of people are going to be selling to more than 5 markets. In terms of the fixed cost of exporting, we're going to set it so that the US trade share is 0.14. Okay, so that's a moment we nail. We really have no sense of what FX is. There's a lot of estimates in the data, but it's useful to discipline this parameter with something we can observe. We set the convexity of the fixed cost function to 1 or 3. I don't know exactly what it is. And here's coming back to your question before. We're trying to think more about how to get at some distribution of market shares or something like that that would allow us to get at alpha. Which result? Well, it's buried. So this is N. N is not a constant. N is a choice of the agent. So it's N of phi, so it's buried in there. But it's all changing. That's a good question. Okay, the labor supply elasticity, here's where if you ask size, he would say it's 0.2, 0.25. If you ask Chetty, he would say 0.5. You ask Rogerson, he'd say 1.5. So it's hard to know. I think 0.5 is reasonable, but I'm gonna show you a range of estimates of epsilon, and obviously those are associated with different gammas. Now let me highlight a couple of things where we use more data. Okay, and after that I'll just give you a number and we can call it a day. But here's where we use data. So we use this CBO data to get at phi. Okay, so for 2007, it turns out that that's a big scatter plot that I showed you. It works beautifully year by year. This is 2007. It says phi in that year was 0.147. Okay. And what about phi? Okay, that's the main thing. This distribution of ability, what is it? How do we get at the distribution of ability? So that's where we use the model, and we show that if you have data on the distribution of income, you can exactly recover the distribution of ability. Okay, so for that we use US tax data. You go to the NBR, you send a polite email. Turns out they give you millions of observations on reported income in the US. Okay? So we're basically going to use that to find the underlying distribution of ability that exactly matches the distribution of reported income. So here I'm plotting the data and the non-parametric. That's basically the approach we follow in which we say, we're going to choose phi to exactly match the income distribution. You see that we match it perfectly. We could have done something less parametric just to say, let's just use a log normal distribution. And that actually gets you pretty close. You see that all this hype about the Pareto, yet if you choose the log normal distribution that best matches the income distribution, you get pretty close. But you're way off on certain moments of that distribution. If I plot the distribution here, and I plot it in a way that emphasizes the right tail, you see that even though we nailed the right tail because we're doing it by construction, if you had a log normal distribution, you would be way off. You would be missing a lot of very rich people. Okay, the income distribution is not, the right tail is much fatter in the data than it is under a log normal. And this thing being flat, this is what size has emphasized with Piketty and so on, that this flatness is exactly what the Pareto would predict. Okay? So this is basically telling you that And at the same time, let me say one more thing, which is you don't want to just assume a Pareto, because from the 90th percentiles to the left, the Pareto distribution is a terrible distribution for the distribution of income. You don't want to assume that the distribution of income is Pareto, because that's totally crazy. So you need something that is a combination of a Loch normal on the left, Pareto on the right. I don't know exactly what it is, so we're just sort of nailing it, just choosing phi to exactly nail it. And then it's just a matter of doing counterfactuals. By how much does aggregate income go up by trade? With trade, it's going to depend on alpha and epsilon. But you can get, you know, if for low epsilons, you're going to get gains of the orders of 4 to 7%, which are a little bit higher than you would infer from ACR, Arcolac is at all, but they're not huge. Interestingly, as agents' labor supply decisions become more elastic, you're going to get bigger gains from trade, quite intuitively. But importantly, the changes in the Gini coefficient are actually pretty sizable as well. Okay, so you're getting higher gains from trade than you would otherwise, but the model is also generating changes in the Gini coefficient that are non-trivial. Okay, so when you put these things together, then you can go back to the formulas that we had, I'm going to stop very soon, and compute the welfare's correction. Okay, by how much should I deflate this gains from trade, because trade is also increasing inequality, for different values of alpha. Here I have alpha 1 and 3. And here for different values of the inequality aversion rho and the elasticity of labor supply. And what you find here is that no matter what alpha is, it looks like with log utility and labor supply elasticity of epsilon 0.5, which I think are reasonable numbers, you'd get that the gains from trade are 21% lower than they would without an increase in inequality. When you do the costly redistribution correction, you get similar numbers. Depends on the elasticity of labor supply, but it turns out that with an elasticity of labor supply equal to 0.5, you're going to get an adjustment of about 20% or so. Okay, so it looks like about 1/5 of the gains from trade are going to be eroded by either an inequality-averse social planner or a tax system that, or by taking into account the inefficiencies that come from a costly redistribution system. And I'll just stop here. Do we have time for questions?
Yeah. Have like until so 6 minutes for questions. So you have any question? Yes.
So I'm not sure. That's a good question. I mean, I think in terms of that tail index, the Atkinson index, I think we're on pretty solid grounds in the sense that, as a matter of fact, these adjustments that I'm talking about, there's a, at least in the welfare's case, there's a close connection to the Atkinson index of what we're doing. And I'm pretty sure that that it shouldn't matter a lot. If we're looking at the same data, okay, it doesn't matter whether we call that adjustment as a function of the Gini or as a function of something else, we'd come up with the same numbers if we're looking at the same data. For the second aspect, that's sort of different, right, because you're telling me that preferences are a bit more complicated than the simple power function that I have in mind. So, yes, it would matter. I don't know. I'd have to read more about this, but this is... I'm trying to catch up with that literature because you're kind of working on something and then you realize there's a whole army of people that have been doing all this income distribution time for years. And at the same time, the formulas that I showed you, I haven't seen that before. Maybe it's sort of, there's some papers that have pointed some of these things out, but I put it in terms of the Gini, you could put it in terms of other measures. That's that I agree with. Yes. Yeah, it's... No, we know that, yeah, that we know, so for firm size distribution, I've seen it for firm size distribution, I've seen it for distribution of city sizes. Okay, there's different literatures that are basically pointing out the same thing, which is for the bulk of the distributions, the log normal is a pretty good fit, but then we see higher occurrence of this weird big cases than we would otherwise. Now, there's an interesting history here, which is the Pareto distribution, obviously, we all know that comes from Pareto, but it's coming actually because he saw that distribution hold in income distribution. So he was the first to say, look, I'm looking at the income distribution, not the firm size distribution or whatever, the income distribution, and it is Pareto. And you might say, that's strange, because I just said that's crazy. And the reason is that he was focusing on exactly what we're focusing on, which is the distribution of reported income. But he was doing so in the 1920s, maybe, or 19-teens, when nobody paid taxes. Only the very rich people would report income to the federal or to tax authorities. I guess it was in America, whatever. So yes. He was focused. He was finding a Pareto distribution because he was focusing on the top 5%. And if we did that here, we would also say it's Pareto. But again, that's not the formula you want to use throughout the distribution because the bulk of it is log normal.
More questions? I have a question about the technology. Is the same for all countries, and it is not biased against unskilled people?
No, so everybody has the same, exactly. So there's Higgs neutral differences in productivity across agents. But it's sort of, that's a sort of another stark feature of the model, which is there's no sense in which there is a labor market here. I mean, there's not sense in which you're pulling workers together to work and you have a technology that puts them together. The only sense in which there is that is in terms of aggregate output is a aggregator of whatever different people do. But we're all working alone and selling our stuff. So I guess you could put some biases in the aggregator, but I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not sure what that would do. And in any case, it's not something we need to generate the fact that low-skilled people gain less than others. It's just coming from selection into exporting. The trade is this great opportunity that allows your output to be consumed by other people worldwide and allows you to market your stuff in more markets, but if there's some cost of doing so, you might not find it optimal to do that. So relative to the people that do, that you're going to tend to gain less from that shop. So you're saying close to 10%?
Yeah.
Yeah, I always find it amazing how people come up with those numbers, though, because it's sort of.
I'm not sure, but I'm pretty sure that they come really.
Sure. Right. Now the issue is how do you put that in welfare? Okay. So what does it mean? I mean, if our rich people don't pay taxes. But they enjoy bigger yachts and like they have bigger houses and they're happier? Is that part of social welfare? Yes or no? You know, it's not obvious. I mean, maybe it might be obvious to you, but yeah. But Cal, I mean, I'm just saying, maybe I'm not being fair to Keller Hicks, but Keller Hicks might say, well, you know, sort of, I care about aggregate income. It doesn't matter whether it's taxed or not, or whether they have it in some Caribbean islands where they go spend every other weekend. They enjoy it. That's a good thing. Okay. So I don't think that's necessarily reasonable, but it's not obvious. It's not obvious to me exactly how I would sort of put that in. And let alone getting at epsilon in that case. What's the elasticity of reported income relative to generated income to changes in taxes? I'm not sure. We might have some back of the envelope numbers of evasion, but can we actually estimate these elasticities? I don't know. But it's an issue, and I know that a lot of people are talking about this. And it's actually very interesting because at some level it interacts with this shock. Okay, maybe it's not so much trade integration, but we know sort of capital mobility. Thinking about a model where capital mobility doesn't change that epsilon you have in mind, of course it does, right? I mean, that's part of the problem, that money can move around and it's harder to keep track of it. But we're not there yet.
Okay, thank you very much, Paul.
Thank you.